Welcome to Sun City, everyone. Glitzy, glamorous, totally fabulous kitsch resort here in the northwest province of South Africa. It's one of the most interesting histories of any holiday resort on the entire planet. Today, I'm going to tell you the crazy story of the fascinating history of this incredible resort.
Truly rock star views. Look at that.
It's going to be a wild ride. Hello, everyone, and welcome back to CoolCapeTravel.com for fun and informative travel videos. I am standing in front of the Sun Soho Hotel in Sun City, which was the first and original hotel here at Sun City. But first, we need to head back into time to 1964, to Durban, when the first five-star resort hotel in South Africa was constructed, called the Beverly Hills Hotel. This magnificent modernist masterpiece was the first project of the up-and-coming Saul Kirzner. He was only 28 when he built this hotel, and it was the start of great things to come. Fast forward to 1977, and Saul Kirzner is sitting pretty. In the 13 years since he built the Beverly Hills, he formed a company called Southern Sun, and by now it was the largest hotel chain in South Africa, and soon to be the largest in the Southern Hemisphere. The innovation that Kirzner imported from the USA to the South African hospitality industry had catapulted the South African tourism industry onto the international stage during a time when the South African economy was in a relentless boom period thanks to high gold prices. And by now it would appear that everything that Kirzner touched turned to gold. And this is where things start to get really interesting. In what can be seen as the pinnacle of cruelty and disregard for anyone who wasn't white, in 1977, the apartheid regime created a phony homeland system to dump black people in. Pretoria created these self-governing homelands as an attempt to soothe the black majority agitating for a vote in national affairs and to show the international community that black people indeed are in charge of their own destiny in South Africa. Most were located on desolate tracts of land, far from major urban centers, and four of them, including Bobuta Tswana, were granted independence by South Africa and had black heads of state. These bits of low-quality land, supposedly enshrined as independent black homelands, were in fact just one of the struts of the apartheid regime. They amounted to parched rural ghettos, as almost all of the arable land in the region remained in the hands of white farmers, and the UN deplored the Homelands Foundation as merely cementing the system. You big disgrace. No other country in the world recognized these homelands as real countries except for South Africa, but that was all that Saul Kirzner needed. Kirzner saw a massive opportunity. South Africa was in the iron grip of draconian apartheid laws and the strict and stifling Calvinistic societal expectations of the almighty Dutch Reformed Church. But none of these rules or expectations existed in the Great Republic of Bobuta Tswana, everyone. Like a bat out of hell, Mr. Kirzner made his way to Bobuta Tswana, where he cozied up with Lukas Mangope, the new leader of this Mickey Mouse state. It was the start of a very satisfying relationship indeed. In exchange for exclusive gaming rights, Kirzner promised to invest 35 million rand, that's about 1.2 billion rands in today's money, transforming a shrubby patch of bush into a lush resort called Sun City. Mangope grasped the opportunity. It was a tremendous deal for Kirzner, as Sun City would be operating pretty much tax-free as long as Mangope gets his bribes. Yes, everyone, you better hold on to your hat, because the stage is now set for the most fantastical, glam, fabulous story of your life, starring some of your favorite deadly sins and desires, including greed, power and corruption, fame, decadence, opulence, and lust. The ink on the deal wasn't even dry yet before bulldozers started rolling into an extinct volcanic crater that Kirzner spotted out of a helicopter. Even though the deal was widely derided, Kirzner pushed through relentlessly. It wasn't long before a glam, fabulous pleasure palace designed to meet the every whim of the fun-starved millionaire playboys of Johannesburg and Pretoria started taking shape. And Kirzner made sure that it had everything to make their very wildest dreams come true. It shall have a grand theater for topless feathered extravaganzas,
And girls, 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 and gambling. The largest casino and roulette operation outside of the United States, with the most advanced casino that money can buy, decked out in gold and mirrors. And it shall have a glam, fabulous country club and luxury spa, with a superlative golf course designed by Gary Player. It still ranks in the top 100 golf courses to this day, and a man-made lake for powerboat water sports. And a super sleek pool deck, oh yes. Just look at its super modern, sleek, glam-fabulous lines blending effortlessly into the bush. Yes, everyone, I give you the one and only original Sun City Hotel and Casino. In December 1979, Sol Kerzner opened the doors to Sun City, and South Africans quickly dubbed it Sin City. Gambling, topless dancers, all-night drinking, pornography, and mixing with black people, including black prostitution, were now just a two-hour drive from Johannesburg. It was an instant, explosive, and overnight success.
It is still here intact today, pretty much the way it was built in 1979.
As the sun rose over Sun City and its 340 five-star air-conditioned and luxury rooms in the bush, it was opening to an expectant, fun-starved population and a deeply disapproving world. South Africa had a white middle class with a big thirst for adventure and with big money to spend. During its opening weekend, the queues to get inside were more than 20 kilometers long. The hotel was running on an average occupancy of over 90%, and Southern Sun profits doubled overnight. The high rollers from Johannesburg and Pretoria just kept on rolling in. Everyone in South Africa was talking about it, but no one would admit they went there.
It was all sinfully delicious.
It was a glorious and glitzy manifestation of the moral bankruptcy of the apartheid regime, and we couldn't get enough of it. A pleasure palace where the shackles of the oppressive apartheid regime were briefly forgotten by privileged white people. After church, we rushed to get to the Sunday papers just to get a glimpse behind the curtains into the glamour and decadence of Sun City. By 1981, insatiable demand meant that capacity was nearly doubled with the addition of the less formal Cabanas Hotel on the left of the screen here, and the entertainment center a little up the hill. It added another fabulous space-age casino, but the real showstopper was the 7,000-seat Super Bowl. It was Africa's most advanced music hall, with a $2.5 million in 1981 money sound system and a world-class music stage crew. Now all they needed to do was fill it with the biggest stars in the world. Even though South Africa was under a strict international United Nations cultural boycott, this was no problem for Sun City, since it wasn't in South Africa, and that's how it was sold to international artists. If you play here, you don't play in South Africa, and you won't be playing to a segregated audience. What sealed the deal, though, were the eye-watering amounts of money that were paid that would make a Las Vegas talent booker blush. Sun City was the highest paying gig an artist could get in the 1980s anywhere in the world for the least amount of work. When Frank Sinatra, who is generally perceived as one of the greatest musical artists of the 20th century, bagged $20 million in today's money to open the Super Bowl in 1981, it was a stunning propaganda coup for Sun City and the South African government, as it legitimized the homelands and apartheid system, and it paved the way for a procession of global superstars to clamor for the stage at the Sun City Super Bowl.
The party was now truly going into overdrive. At once, another glam fabulous five-star hotel was added. The super modern Cascades, with its sleek twin pyramid design, towered over the bush and the resort like an Aztec temple. Its spectacular swimming pools and landscaping was never seen before in this part of the world. Sun City had quickly become one of the most famous resorts and hottest tickets in the whole world. Africa's first and only monorail was added to whisk day visitors from the car park and deliver them straight into the casino. The casinos were so insanely popular you couldn't find room to walk in there over weekends. All that tax-free gambling activities had turned Sun City into a money-printing machine, and all that dirty money came in very handy to lure in the biggest stars on the planet. Here we are at the helicopter landing pads of Sun City, everyone.
Not one, not two, but three helicopter landing pads. Yes, everyone. The most famous people on the planet in the 1980s would have landed right here. And here follows a list of some of them. Boney M., Air Supply, Elton John, Gloria Gaynor, Barry Manilow, Bigelow, Leo Sayer, Queen, Rod Stewart, Dolly Parton, Liza Minnelli, George Benson, Liberace, Tina Turner, Ray Charles, Isaac Hayes, The OJs, Millie Jackson, Brooke Benton, Chicago, Cher, Laura Branigan, Shirley Bassey, Olivia Newton-John, The Osmonds, The Beach Boys, Status Quo, Modern Talking, Grace Jones, Eartha Kitt, Linda Ronstadt, Kenny Rogers, Curtis Mayfield, and all of the famous tennis players and boxers. The Dream Machine was now going into hyperdrive and Sun City was defying gravity. You are now looking at the poster boy of moral bankruptcy of the apartheid regime and your favorite tour guide.
Welcome to Sun City, everyone.
Everybody, we will win.
So fast, cowboy. Yes, what goes up must come down, but unfortunately we have now run out of time. Stay tuned for the next chapter of this incredible resort, everybody. And if you think you've seen it all, you ain't seen nothing yet.